is a youth educator in our Department of Ecosystem Science and Management with Cooperative Extension. And he was formerly a county, in the counties, came back here, and now is a professor of extension.
That's the title.
Yeah.
Associate teaching professor.
And I know a lot of you, well, Danielle, a lot of others have worked with Sandy on habitat judging, and a lot of youth outreach opportunities, and for those of you who are new, you'll get to know Sandy later on.
Okay, so thank you, Margaret. What I'm going to ask Margaret to do is give you all a piece of paper, and I just want to show you something. This was being recycled. I like to use recycled stuff. Does anybody know what this is besides a fish? You have a, this. No, actually, all of these open up. So this is what we used to use before computers for clip art. And this was very much useful in my career. I've been around for a while. So that before we had computers, we would cut this stuff out on a photocopier or shrink it and then paste it with a blue stick and then make photocopies of everything. We didn't have computers. So I want you to make a name tent for me. Okay, of course I know some of you, but go ahead and make it as creative as you want. And here's some. But it's be as creative as you want. You want it to stand up right this way or that way, but all I want is your first name.
But you're not giving them these clip art to go with.
They can have those. They can take home. They're going to make a name tent from the blank side. You don't even have to use the blank side if you want. You can use any side you want.
Like the leaves.
Yeah. So that's just so I can call you by name individually. And and then what we're going to give you are clickers. And this is the portable clicker system,
thanks,
which I use for working with groups. And people love it, especially older people who've never used clickers. And I've never worked with clickers in classrooms. We used were transparency groups, like forehead projectors. Isn't that funny? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm
not sure.
Yeah, Margaret, I remember you using slides.
Yeah, no, I started with transparency.
But we also used just overhead projectors.
Right,
oh,
okay.
Yeah.
So things have changed a little bit. All right, so Margaret mentioned that I work with youth education, and I do,
thanks,
but I do a lot of adult education. In fact, I'd say maybe 25% of my time is with adult education, and mostly with forest landings for teachers. Teachers or non-formal kind of educators, people work in state parks and such, I work with them. And we focus, or sometimes we talk a lot about kids, but sometimes we just talk about forest land management too, because that's certainly something that I'm interested in. And, let me see here.
And Sandy, of course, for this class, that's the Zadian Outreach, is learning how to do outreach education for
right.
kids and adults.
That's right. Oh, for kids and adults. Yeah, and that's important, because if you just focus on kids, you kind of might miss out on those people that want to work with kids. So if you want to work with kids or make a bigger impact on youth, certainly working with adults, especially adults who have kids, is really great. I just want to kind of okay, so we're not going to go to sleep, but we expect that to make it clear to you. And we haven't checked the clickers yet to see if this is all going to read properly, but it was really going to find in my office. Said, there's my name. Just call me Sandy today, and if you ever want to come see me, I'm up in 335, which is on the third floor, so it's a floor below Margaret's office, but in the other wing of the building. And I did work in a county extension office in a region of Pennsylvania, the northwestern region, which is up by Erie, Warren, Forest, Crawford, those counties, for 10 years, and then I've been here for 20 plus years now. I'm going my 21st year here. I came here for two reasons. One, to work on a PhD, but another to do a state-level job, which I've done something similar to that for all these years. What I'm going to do today is talk a little bit about today's youth. And I know, Jason, you work a lot with youth through Shavers Creek, right?
So yeah, I'm actually thinking maybe this would be a good presentation to provide to our staff at some point, too.
Okay, well, I'd be happy to. We've got a lot to talk about if you want to talk about that. But I think most of you know, and I'm not considering you youth here today. I mean, most of you are, you know, anybody 18 and up is an adult. And so, but the youth today, meaning people less than 18, are kind of different than they were maybe 10 or 20 or even 30 years ago. When I first started working, youth were kind of different than they are today. One way they're different is that they spend the majority of their time indoors, connected to the internet or, you know, doing homework or watching television or something, but there's a lot more indoor time, okay? I'm not making any value judgments on this. This is just the way it is, and I think you guys will agree that people do spend a lot of time indoors. We all do. Connected in many respects. And also, as I've worked with youth over the years, I've found that they really lack knowledge and understanding about nature and natural resource topics. So it's just a trend. You know, you spend more time indoors, you're going to know less about the outdoors. You don't grow up on a farm or in a rural area, you're not going to have a lot of that instinctual knowledge that someone who did will have. And then also, you have a lot of misconceptions and fears about the outdoors these days. And if you had the opportunity to work with younger kids in outdoor settings, you do find that kids come to programs sometimes very fearful of what they're going to encounter. If it isn't ticks, or bears, or rattlesnakes, or, you know, something else, too much sun, or allergies, different things, you know, it's something else. And so things are a little different. But I worked then 4-H camps for some years, a long time ago, and when we brought kids from very urban areas, and we had a share of tech kids, and they would come from urban areas to these rural camps, it was very difficult for anyone. 25 years ago, 30 years ago, it was difficult to get them to relax in the outdoors. It just wasn't comfortable sometimes for them at first. Some of you may have heard of a book called Last Child in the Woods. If you haven't, I do recommend this. It was written something like 15 years ago. It has been updated since then, since the first copy. And it was written by a man named Richard Loo. And in that book, he coined a term called nature deficit disorder. And you can imagine from that title that it kind of means that people are suffering from a lack of nature in their lives. And he didn't just, he wrote this book about children and how that lack of time in nature, lack of connection to nature, has changed childhood and kids physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, in all sorts of ways. But he also has another book called The Nature Principle, which is almost the same thing, but about how the lack of nature has affected adults, you know, how adults are really not connected anymore either. And that's a whole other talk. I used to give a talk like that. I haven't for a while. But some of the things that he looked at, and he's not a researcher. He was a writer. And so he spent a number of years digging out all the literature, which is buried, you know, because people don't read scientific literature very often. And he kind of digested it and regurgitated it into a format that people could understand this topic better. And he wrote one of the most influential books of the last 20 years. And I actually met him once, and he said, yeah, I think he had written something like 15 books before this book. And, you know, didn't even realize he was going to be striking a nerve when he did this. But this book kind of set him up for life, and he's done a lot of things as a result of that. But some of the things he talked about was the research that showed that because kids don't spend time outdoors anymore, in all different ways and all different times of their lives, they're suffering from a number of different physical diseases, you know, sort of obesity problems, issues, various kinds of allergies that kids didn't used to have, you know, that they got exposure to when they were young, but now they don't get any exposure to some things. And then talked about a lot of psychological kinds of things, just sort of
the ability to be relaxed and peaceful and to be able to be focused on numerous things rather than, you know, it's just be attention on a screen or on a tablet or something like that. So you know, you talk about all those kinds of physical and emotional sort of aspects of being without a connection to nature, and that's, he coined the term nature deficit disorder. Some people have said that's not really a diagnosis of anything in particular, but as you, it's a very convincing argument, and clearly a lot of the research that he uncovered that had been done already formed a pretty good thesis. Okay, so now we're going to get to user clickers. So the question is, who or what most instilled a love of the outdoors and nature in you? And the way to use your clicker is just, you have five choices here, so you can press 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, you know what? I see we're not connected. Okay. So let me escape and go out of this. Turning point is the software that runs the clickers. Open the program. Alright, now it's good. So go ahead and vote a 1 to a 5. If you change your, you're going to compare it, I'll compare it to the, what the research says. And I did say, well, I didn't underline who or what most is. So of course it's not good. So I probably should put, you know, an animal on there or something. That would be interesting. But that's good. I'm glad you told us that. So what did you click then? Did you click person? Because
I did put place just because it was, I mean, it was Louisiana in the bayous, and okay, it was just kind of distinct, right, of the
that's
area.
Fine. So that'll help us to interpret our results here. So you have place there instead of a creature. And then another question here. When did you first develop a love and appreciation for the outdoors? About 8, about 9 there yet? Everybody try again. Sometimes it's kind of a spongy. There we got it. Okay, somebody just hadn't voted yet. Okay. You see how this is fun? 100% as a child. Okay. We got one more question here. Was there a special place? So now I'm kind of narrowing it down. Was there a special place in the outdoors where you spent time as a child? If so, was it a camp, barn, forest area? And if it was a swamp or some other thing, just say forest area for that matter. Now, or you could put other if you want, but it's a forest area can be represent any kind of natural area. Or a park specifically, you know, like a state park or county park, and then other. Well, you know, anything else? Yeah, anything that doesn't, it's not one of the four. I can't think of something right offhand, but let's say other might be a tree outside your window in town. Okay. Nope. Ranch. A ranch is a farm. A farm is a ranch. Okay, so survey says here that most of you say it was a forest area or a natural area. I could change that line. There's some natural area. All right. So what research says that for almost everyone who has a love and appreciation for the outdoors, it was planted and cultivated by adults, almost always a parent, but sometimes a grandparent, and then occasionally a teacher or something like that, right? And then it was instilled very early, and you guys might agree with that, or you're consistent with what the research says, and it's often connected to a specific place. So it's sort of a three-level thing going on here that kind of got that love and appreciation going in you.
And so you were not at all abnormal, you know, you're right in line with them. And it's always that way when I talk to groups, especially that are interested in the outdoors. It is not always that way, obviously, when I talk to groups that are just general mixed public kind of groups. Okay. Anything surprising there to you? Is it surprising that parents are really the key person that often passes that on?
You know, I think if we did our students in general,
yeah,
we'd get a lot of TV. You know, because I think, you know,
yeah,
I mean, I think this is a subset of our students, yeah, who are super interested, but we have a lot of people come into the lot of meetings and say, kind of, by the way.
Yeah, I like to watch it on television. Nature.
Yeah.
Nature or,
yeah,
you know, Nova or something
like
that. Did any of the students here grow up watching Wildcrats?
Yeah, I'm sure.
Like, my kids love Wildcrats. When,
yeah,
we do programs, when kids just start spouting out information, it's almost always from Wildcrats.
Wildcrats?
Wildcrats.
Never heard of them. Maybe
I should start. But, yeah.
And I'm going to mention here that, you know, even though TV doesn't show up as one of the big ones, certain movies and certain books are definitely influential in people's lives, and in my life it wasn't. I'll mention that a little later here. If you go along. Sorry, I'm smudging my glasses. Okay, so put it, you know, so essentially what we've said here is when you're young, adults, specifically parents, or most often parents, instill this love and appreciation is often connected to a specific place. Well, the research really bore out what Rachel Carson said. 1960, in a book that she was working on called
Was it Sense of Wonder?
The Sense of Wonder, right, for, about you. That if a child is to keep alive their inborn sense of wonder, he or she needs the companionship of at least one adult who can share it, rediscovering with him or her the joy, excitement, and mystery of the world we live in. Okay, she raised a nephew. And she died just in the process of writing this, so she didn't live that long. But she pretty much summed it up without having done all the research. But there is a lot of research, and it falls in a couple areas, but one of them is significant life experiences, where they've done research and they go out and research about environmental educators and others, you know, and so they've pointed to these different things that I mentioned, parent or another adult, happens when you're young. So the bottom line here is, for you all, is that you remember how you got this love and appreciation, and adults are the key for young people to get that connection. So as you're moving away from university and working in different capacities, it's really an awesome responsibility that you have to spread that love and appreciation. That's what Shaker's Group is in the business of doing. There. I was wondering, why didn't I have the title of the book there? Okay, so speaking of television, I'm going to use some information that the dinosaur doctor, right? Dinosaur doctor. And his name is escaping me right now. But the guy that does the dinosaur train program, he left a tenured position at the University of Denver, I think. Was a paleontologist, and he spent 2 years really looking into what forms nature connections and what's the most, one of the most important kind of tips that he could pass on to others so they would understand this. Well, as I read his book, his name is Samson, Matt Samson, I think it is, I'll find here in a minute. He talked about, or he tried to elicitate from literature what adults can do to really encourage this nature connection, because he knows how important adults are. And he kind of summarized it in one formula where he says experiences plus mentoring and understanding on the part of the child leads to a nature connection. Okay, so experiences in the outdoors, and it can be multiple, many experiences. Sometimes it can be one incredible wilderness experience. And then the mentoring of an adult, and then increasing that understanding of the young person that you're working with. And he's talking here about a broad understanding, not just very specific about the DNA and toes, but more, you know, just how things work in nature, kind of a cycles understanding, a web understanding of nature, which is a broad understanding. And he summarized it in the term EMU. Easy to remember that. Experiences, mentoring, and understanding. Matt Sampson, and I just want to emphasize, this is my own point here, is that this is not rocket science. Just like it's very simple to kind of understand what it, what was involved in creating that love and appreciation for nature in you, talking about the tips and remembering some of these tips is not rocket science. And if you take these things to heart, I think you'll realize that you can do this. Anybody can do this. Working with you, you don't have to have an education degree or specialization at all. It helps. So I'm going to give you 6 tips that are largely from him, the dinosaur doctor, dinosaur trained doctor, but I've adapted them to my own personal 30 years experience in this field. And the first one is that you really need to provide abundant experiences in natural places close to home. So if you're raising children or if you're working with children, there's 100 good reasons why just spending time just outside here in the front or around the gardens or over the arboretum or just close to home on a regular basis will get that connection going. Okay, that's really an important point. Sometimes people say, well, we gotta go to the mountains, we gotta go to the Ricketts Glen, we gotta go to, you know, the Tetons or something, to have this wilderness experience. But in fact, as young people are growing up, living their lives wherever they live, they can connect with nature wherever they are, even in cities and such, in parks, and greenways, and abandoned areas and such. There are all different places close to just about everybody. And it's this repetition, this repeated experiences that's more important than driving off somewhere far away for that one kind of capstone experience. So related to this fundamental, mentoring fundamental, I'll give you a few tips, and these are largely my own. With some of Samson's ideas too. Make nature a regular habit, and that's basically that repeated thing, you know, just keep it happening. And plan repeat visits. So, you know, going to one place once doesn't mean, okay, we've been there, done that. You want to go repeatedly because there's so many things that change through the year, especially in a place like Pennsylvania, that it's really going to make an impact on kids to see change over time, you know, through the seasons and such. Invite wild into kids' everyday lives. And so what we're talking about here is bird feeders or other ways to connect to wild life, be it plant or animal, in your yard or around your home. Now, lots of people don't have yards and homes, you know, in the classic sense, but they have apartment buildings or other places. So maybe you find another place where you can help fill the feeders or find a place close to home where you are kind of inviting the wild to come in a little closer for viewing and experiencing. Big part of getting kids to be comfortable in the outdoors is helping them learn how to dress right. There's no such thing as bad weather, there's just crummy clothes. Think that way. And so if you dress properly, like yesterday I got stuck outside a lot during the day and I didn't have any warm clothes on. Boy, was it cold, and I was so miserable, and I could barely pay attention. You know, I was on a field trip, and I could barely pay attention. Had I been dressed properly, I could have just stayed out there all day. And I'm a person that likes to be outdoors all day as a hunter and as a professional forester. And so I have a good idea how to dress for success, but I didn't really realize I was going to be outside in the cold all day yesterday. Okay. And then seek naturally inspirational places and times. So, evening, going out in evenings, early morning can be really inspirational for young people. Certain places can be more inspirational. You know, you have a choice around your home. And then sometimes I'm thinking of Carly and Carly just dropping kids off or sending kids out to just learn about nature from someone else. Well, then you're missing an opportunity, a big opportunity. And I know some of you may not have children yet, but if you're working with a group, for example, if you have an attitude about nature such that it's not, you know, you're not jazzed about it or not excited about it, they're going to pick up on that. Okay, so let's talk about some tips related to this. So you as an adult working in environmental education need to know what you have in regards to nature centers and
environmental education centers nearby, that you might want to use some of those or visit them yourself so that you can ramp yourself up a little bit if you're not making the connections or haven't made connections to, like, you know, you could have, I guess, recently. You want to seek out nature media that will inspire you. A couple books, now these are adult level kinds of books here. Sand County Almanac, The Forest Unseen, or Bringing Nature Home are all great books for adults, young and old, to read. They're not children's books, you know, they're not going to be something you'd give to a 10-year-old, but they're really going to inspire you about nature and about the intricacies of nature and just kind of give you a sense of purpose and mission. Movies and music can also inspire some folks. If you're, I know you all are not in this category, but if you're not an adult, if you were not an adult who's really connecting with nature or knows much about nature, you can enlist support from some of your more nature-oriented friends. So if you had a friend, if you weren't a birder or you know, a person that liked to spend time outdoors, you might have some friends that are and that could inspire you. And then build partnerships to access expertise and experiences. So here again, if you don't know the lay of the land in your area, and there's environmental education centers or other groups you could work with, building partnerships with them, let's say you're working for an agency, you know, a biologist or something, you want to make connections in those places so that you can, you know, tap into what they've learned about the area, what they're doing, and the expertise, because sometimes you'll make friends there, you might meet Jason and say, hey, would you come on over and talk to a group that I'm going to be working with this weekend or wherever I am. So this mentoring tip is really all about you, but it's so important that you be of the right frame of mind and the right modeling whenever you're with kids. And then this last one, very obvious again, in some ways, tailor experiences and programs to kids' specific ages, stages, and interests. Okay, if you're working one-on-one with your own children, then this is a lot easier because you know your kids, you know their stages very well. But if you're working for a state agency, and let's say you're called up by a group and they want to bring out a group of kids to your park or to your office, you're going to get to talk to them about something, you really want to know as much as you can about the age level that you're going to have and the interests that they have, more specifically, because you might really miss the mark, and you can do a whole lot better when you custom tailor your programs. And I've taken that approach for 30 years that I've been doing this kind of stuff, and I never change it. From the beginning, I always was considering, okay, how many kids are there, what age levels, because if you have different levels, that can be challenging. What's sort of the general background of the kids, and what are the interests, or what's the interest of the adult, and what do they think are the interests of the kids? Okay. Some tips under this would be to observe children's interactions with nature and follow their lead. So this is in particular if you're working with your own children or family members. Encourage exploration and observation among those kids. And then sharpen their senses and awareness through different types of activities. And these are kind of, there's so many different activities, and I'll suggest a few sources of these later, but wanders in the outdoors, solo sitting, you know, sitting in one place through over the course of a year, maybe every week, every other week, to kind of document the changes through journaling. Scouting reports are always fun when you get kids together where they report to each other things, natural things they've seen in the last week or month. In 4-H groups and Boy Scout groups, sometimes that works pretty good. Storytelling about nature, questioning, you know, is a technique you use when teaching kids in the outdoors where you kind of give them open-ended questions and let them explore what the answers might be. 4-H projects can also be part of those sharpening awareness activities that you might do. So different tips there related to custom tailoring programs. All right, these last three fundamentals are simple again. Again, they're not rocket science. And it's coming back to that first one here, especially, these are age level specific fundamentals. So between the ages of 2 and 6, getting kids outside, giving them space, and letting them play during those early childhood years is what needs to happen. You know, there's not a lot you're going to teach them specifically at that age level, but except comfort and familiarity with nature. You know, just the desire to be out in nature, just to connect. naturally, let them do the exploring. It's sort of like almost a sixth sense that kids have is, you know, the sense of knowing how to do something or wanting to do something in the outdoors. So it's a natural thing if you cultivate. This picture reminds me, this was some years ago, but every summer I would do this international camp for 2 to 6 year olds, and they were all children of international students here, and it was out at Laurel Haven, where Margaret owns them. You know, most of those kids had not been outside very much. You know, they came from China or from Japan, and they lived in an apartment here in town, like a graduate student housing apartment and such. And boy, did they go wild in the outdoors. You know, and they hardly had to do anything with them because, you know, they were digging in the dirt and looking at bugs. And just for some of them, it was like the first time they'd had a chance to get out. Many of them had just arrived to state college from other countries. Okay, some tips about when working with young kids is to promote that free, unstructured play. And in the book, Last Child in the Woods, he talks a lot about this too. Unstructured play really just means, you know, letting them play, letting them explore. But you need to do it with some boundaries. You know, you can't let them the wrong way and then never find them again. You have to say, okay, you know, you see that, you know, house over there, don't go any farther than that, and there's some yellow flagging up in the woods up there, and over here there's a fence, so that's the area that you're going to stay in. So always boundaries are always good. Encourage nature as a context for it. I think many of, I suspect if I checked with each one of you, you all experienced nature as a contact kind of thing, that you weren't told, don't touch, you can't pick up that bug, you know, don't hold that frog. You were probably kids that experienced nature with your hands too, right? And there are, you know, attitudes today where people think, no, you can't touch things, you can't dig a hole, you can't pluck a leaf or whatever. I don't think that really is going to get the connection going very strongly if you can't do that. Connect with critters, same kind of thing, you know, holding critters and such. There's correct ways to do it, but you know, connecting with critters, frogs. One of my grandsons, just yesterday I saw in a family blog, he was releasing his toads for the winter. You know, he's kept toads in his bedroom all summer long, and now he's got to release the toads, and they have the funniest names there. Like ones that are all toad and ones that are toad, I don't know. But it was a big day for him. He's seven, I think, and just releasing those little toads was tough, but he's really connected with nature through those toads. And he would collect their food in the summer, you know, so he's out there learning bugs and learning what toads eat. That's the kind of stuff that makes that nature connection. Okay, enjoy nighttime adventures, you know, with young kids. If they are with you and you provide a safe environment, nighttime adventures are pretty cool for young kids. And then provide the best toys to your young kids when you go out with them. Any ideas what the best toys might be?
Nets.
Nets, there's a good one.
Magnifying glass.
Magnifying glass, is not a good one.
Container.
Yeah. Okay, another good one.
Rubber boots,
great. Binoculars. Okay, those are all great, and there's no one right answer to this. And this, what I'm going to show you, is not research-based, but I love it. And it's from Wired Magazine, and a guy named John Liu, I think his name is, wrote an article, and he said the best toys for kids are, and see if you can see why these are the best toys, stick, box, string, cardboard tube, and dirt. Okay, and John Liu is his name. The five best toys of all time. So what do they have in common?
They're simple. You can do a lot with them.
You can do a lot with them because they're not what?
Prepackaged
or not. They're not made for one specific thing. You know, if you get the kids a car, a toy car, well, they kind of know what that is, right? They're going to make a noise and drive it around. But each of these allows for their imaginations, right? And I think, you know, this is one of these things, it's not rocket science, but it's true. And kids just will have so much more fun with a bunch of these things than they will with something that's made for something specific. Now, a net,
could be in this list, or, you know, rubber boots or binoculars could be in this list. Rubber boots would be more of the dress that you're teaching them.
Well, you know, it's funny because people always talk about kids at Christmas and they also say your young kids being much more interested in the box.
In the box. With the ribbon.
Right. Right.
But I like the fact that dirt's the last one. I mean, think of all the things that kids do with dirt. They make dirt balls, they dig holes in the dirt, they make mud pies. Their imagination can just be much more entertaining than anything else that you would buy and give them. And this is, we're talking that 2 to 6 year old kind of range, but it's true for, you know, all of us in some respects, is that we like to use our imagination. I mean, think of all the things kids use sticks for. I mean, that's pretty much the first thing they want to pick up, and they turn it into a gun, they turn it into a fishing pole, they turn it into a laser gun or something. Okay. Now,
you could put someone's eye out with that.
Yeah, right. So, but, you know, you can provide these sort of things, like the string and the bobs and cardboard too. May have to be an issue for the kids before they go out, so to speak. But the dirt and the stick are freely available. And there's a link there. Okay, so let's move up to the kind of the middle years. Foster nature experiences. Foster nature experiences with exploration, autonomy, and demonstrations of competence during these middle years. Think about kids that are in this age bracket, 7 to 12, more of a helicopter mentor, so that when they need you, you come zooming in to help, but then you go back. So you don't want to be a hummingbird over the top of them all the time, but you want to be a helicopter bird coming in to help them or mentor them. Exploring nature arts. For some kids, this is a great way to make a connection. And these kids right here were in Park Forest Middle Schools a few years ago, and they were doing installations. So I was doing a program with their school, and the art teacher came along, and she had a whole curriculum about nature installations. And we did this for a few years. And the installation there is on the ground. Let's see. This one. Right there, stone and mosses and such actually that big. So it looks a little like a campfire or something, but it's actually just nature objects that they put together. Kids really enjoy doing things like that. But you share your nature passions or work by the season. So if you have a kind of an outdoor area where you can get kids connecting with nature by sharing your passions and then what you like to do in the outdoors, and so maybe that's fishing, traditionally fishing and hunting were big things. But then you have bird watching, you know, obviously for the group like this, you have all the other things, hiking, day hiking, camping, what else? You know, everything, all the other forms of outdoor recreation that people enjoy doing. And if this is the perfect age level to get them involved in those things that you like to do. Carly, do you do anything out in the outdoors that you're passing on your kids like?
We do a lot of hiking and trail running. I like to ice skate. I'm actually not very good at it.
So,
what?
It's all right.
Ice skating?
Being good at it isn't the right thing. It's sharing your, you know, interest and your love of that, because kids are very impressionable, especially at this age level, about what their parents enjoy doing. Oops, this is not working. Okay, and then look into local nature groups and clubs. So you're... your kids, you know, are at this age level are getting much more social and like to interact with other people. And lots of times they're different age levels. And so, you know, if there's a bird club like State College has, or if there's a Pheasants Forever group, or a National Wild Turkey Federation, or there's a Shavers, Friends of Shavers Creek activities or regular activities at a local outdoor center, this is a great time to start connecting them in. And when they're really young, going to some of those places is great every once in a while, but that's not really what we want to be focusing. We want to focus on that repeated outdoor contact. But at this age level, nature centers and places like that are great to look into. I remember a National Audubon Society Center as a kid that I really liked to go to. I remember a National Wildlife Refuge, a Swamp Wildlife Refuge that was really important to me, and then my own family's property. And then moving on to the upper age level are the adolescents. Okay? At this age level, it's so much more important to adolescents. You encourage opportunities for regular time in the wild and wild nature. And wild nature means more wild areas rather than just the backyard kind of wild area. Doing challenging, adventurous activities or working outdoors with peers. So doing things with peers is so critical at this age level. If your own children are receptive to doing stuff, that's great with you. But otherwise, if you're working with a group or you're trying to advise a parent how to get a team to connect more, talk about working, doing things with peers. Okay? Things I think of here might involve scouting activities or outward bound or other kinds of groups that are peer groups, and you're doing adventurous kinds of challenging things in the outdoors. Okay, tips here, and you have to schedule it with kids in this age level because they're so busy usually doing a lot of other things. You've got to make nature the place for adventure, so rather than some other place anyway, nature needs to be something that you really make cool in some respects. Seek nature service and learning opportunities. So a lot of kids at the high school level have to do service projects of one sort or another, and there are lots of service opportunities. Trail maintenance would be a great one in this area. In the Rothrock Park, there's all these individuals that are doing segments of trails, and connecting with a few of those people and say, hey, can we help you with your second segment of the trail? I was just out in Rocky Gap Natural Area. Some of you know that area out in Stone Valley. It's a beautiful natural area. It's called the Rocky Gap Natural Area. It's near Three Sisters. It's down outside of McAlevey's Fort, anyway. And ran into the trail maintenance guy. And he was walking along with his chainsaw on his back. And we just connected. We spent a lot of time talking and such. And I went away thinking, what a cool guy. He's doing this in his retirement. But I had no idea what he was and who he was. So then after that, I went up to the bird watching platform, which I think some of you went to, right?
Stone Mountain. Okay, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Stone Mountain.
Yeah.
And Rocky Gap is to the side of Stone Mountain. It's a separate little ridge, natural area. And they said, I told them about the guy I met. They said, he was our doctor. He's a physician from Huntington. But here he is in his retirement doing trail maintenance. There's lots of people like that that you can connect groups with or kids with. And they can go out and do the trail maintenance. And the trail maintenance people will love it because they're out there doing like a 1 mile segment every quarter, like four times a year or two times a year, and having a group helping them. But that's just one service opportunity. There's so many others. Game Commission does a lot of habitat improvement work, like pruning apple trees, planting trees, bushes, shrubs, and you can help them in those things too. I've done it with groups.
Was that Stan Catala by any chance?
No.
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 He met the Tylers up there in Trudy.
Yeah.
Right? At the platform.
I know Stan's a retired doctor from Huntington, but he may actually still be practicing.
This guy wasn't Stan, I think it was John.
John.
I wish I could remember his name. And then consider rites of passage opportunities. Anybody know what I'm talking about here? Rites of passage. You know how the Native Americans used to have things they called quests, where kids, young fellows would be sent out, young men would be sent out, and they'd stay in the wilderness for a certain amount of time, and they'd seek a vision that would lead them for the rest of their life. And you could call that a rite of passage. You could call maybe getting your first gun to learn how to hunt a rite of passage for many kids in Pennsylvania. Well, at this age level, at the adolescent age level, you should design rites of passage things that are actually pretty influential in a kid's life. Sometimes that could be something like a long-distance hike or a climb up mountain or something like that, or a long-distance bicycle ride. For me, the biggest rite of passage I would say in my life was I rode across the United States on my bicycle with another guy. So I just graduated high school. This is something I wanted to do for years. I'd done all these other trips, but then I took a whole summer and rode across the country, and I'll never forget it. I can tell you, so much about that. Here it is. It was 1976. I figure it was a long time ago. 50 years ago? No, 40-something years ago, yeah. And 41 years ago. And, that was a rite of passage for me. And I'll tell you what, when you're on a bicycle riding across this country,
you're pretty much in touch with nature about 85% of the time, because you're looking at all the roadkill, but you're looking into the woods and the streams and such. I all sorts of experiences, like digging native freshwater clams, you know, and cooking them for dinners, and sleeping in the woods all along the way. There was another guy I went with, we just had a little tent, we set it up off the road, trying to be hidden every time. And so we saw some pretty cool stuff along the way, a lot of like west. Went through Glacier National Park, and through the Rockies everywhere. Okay, so those are the tips. Those were just six tips. The book that inspired me to put together that kind of collection of tips is that book called How to Raise a Wild Child. I think that's the title of it, and I'll show you the book here in 2 minutes. I just want to make a few comments about working with family members versus working with groups. Because some of you are going to have kids someday, hopefully, and or if you're so fortunate, and so there's things you do with your own family members that you can kind of only do with them. And then there's things you can do with groups. There's a whole variety of things you can do with groups. But obviously, it's a very different kind of teaching. So with family members, it allows for very close mentoring. And it allows for less preparation, because you're kind of going out and doing things, you know, on your property or in the area. And you can say, hey, let's go to Shavers Creek today, or let's go to Whipple Dam and go fishing and that kind of stuff. You know, it's very spontaneous. Intensive learning goes on when it's just a parent and a child, or a parent and a few children. I'll tell you about that guy in the picture in a minute. It will include work activities if you do have some wild area in your property. It's often very connected to place and sometimes family heritage and history about that place. It strengthens family and community heritage. You know, when you're growing up in an area and you know where your property fits in, you know the neighbors and such, and you have a sense of your home being connected to natural areas. This gentleman here in this picture is a local falconer who lived here in State College for a number of years. Now he's over in Phillipsburg. He's a friend of mine, and that's his son. And there's not a lot of professional hunting falconers in Pennsylvania. Doug, do you have a sense of how many there are?
I don't know how many there are.
Okay, I think there's only about 150 trained, licensed falconers. He sits up on Bald Eagle Ridge every summer. And I think last year he caught close to 150 different birds of prey. He lets most of them go, but he'll pick one or two, and then he trains for the year to hunt with them, and then he lets them go again. So he's that experienced at training hawks and falcons that he can do it year after year. He never, he'll tell you, it's just so fascinating, the stories he's told me about this process. How he trains them. He never keeps a bird over a year. You know, and yet he can train them to hunt for him and live in for that season, and then that's what he can. That particular falcon, I think it's a falcon.
Redtail.
Is it redtail?
Yeah, that's a juvenile.
Is it the other falcon? Okay.
Yeah, they're only allowed to keep juvenile passage birds, they're called.
Okay. So that was from a few years back, and some of the people, professional photographer spent a day with him, I think. This was one he was pulling out. You see right below the bird is like a, I don't know what you call it, it's like a leg, a trap that has all sorts of loops of nylon there, and he'll put like a
tree. Yeah.
Another term, there's a term for if you're training hawks, but it's not about loops. But that's what family kind of mentoring can be about there. Working with groups, it's a very different thing. And if you know, some of you as wildlife majors or other majors that you're in are going to be working for agencies or organizations, this is maybe what you're going to start doing before you start working with individual children of your own. When you're working with groups, you can impact greater numbers. It does often require some curriculum or prepared experiences, because teachers often want to know what you're going to do, how you're going to do it, and what are going to be sort of the results. Involves mixed age stages sometimes. You know, if you're working with a 4-H group in particular, that's very much mixed ages, right? You can have kids that are 8, you can have kids that are 18, but usually there's one different than that, usually between 8 and 12. So there's some challenges with that. You know, how do you speak to an 8-year-old and keep the 12-year-old interested, or how do you keep the 12-year-old interested and help the little ones come along? This kind of learning that goes on is less intensive, and it can incorporate a diversity of views and values, because you have a group, but by that is you can, a group comes in and you don't know much about the group, and you can find, I've worked with groups, for example, where a number of the kids were Hindus and their parents were Hindus and they didn't want us collecting holding insects too much. You know, they didn't want to hurt anything. They didn't, you know, they had a very different understanding of how to hold, you know, kind of interact with insects. But there's all sorts of things that people, you know, will come to your group with that you kind of have to kind of figure out and work with. All right. So if you're starting out as a young professional and you get the opportunities to work with groups, what are some of the resources you might tap? And the first one I would say is there's always lots of people resources wherever you are. So I'll just talk about Pennsylvania here for a minute. So if you're working here in Center County or Forest County, what are some of the counties you're all from if you know your county? Sometimes people don't think in terms of county, but what county are you from?
Snyder.
Jefferson.
Washington.
All western here so far. Daniel, you're not.
I'm from Indiana.
Indiana.
Indiana County.
Wendy?
I'm from
New Jersey.
Yeah.
Okay. So what county are you in?
Huntington County.
Yeah. Carly?
Huntington County.
PA, right? Jake, are you a PA guy?
Not originally.
No. Louisiana or somewhere?
At some point, but Massachusetts mostly.
Massachusetts and?
Maryland.
Okay. So there's different names for some of these kinds of people, but in Pennsylvania we have these service foresters. They're foresters that work in the county. Right? They work for the state, and they'll help the programs sometimes very well. Do PAFs are a specific group. These are called master forest landowners, in kind of a general term. We call them Pennsylvania forest stewards. And these are people who have taken some training about their forest land, and they help to encourage other forest landowners to do the right thing on their property. And then there are extension educators, that's people like myself or people in the county offices that educate the public about different areas. Professional foresters, local treasures, those are people who are just, you know, very into something in your area. It could be a fly tying kind of enthusiast, could be a bird watcher. People that just have a real love for one particular thing and they can help you and share their knowledge with kids. We also have something called conservation districts here that sometimes they have an environmental educator. Often they're, available, accessible. Formal educators, some teachers in the community, sometimes they're nature lovers too, so they like to get involved in things. Nature center educators, state parks, many of them have seasonal employees. Now Greenwood Furnace, you have the full-time person out there in the hall, right? But
right.
Did you ever have a seasonal person there?
He's had interns.
Interns, yeah, in summer. So usually you have to go to the parks to interact with them. And then family members. You know, some of your family members may be a whole lot more kind of knowledgeable about something in the outdoors that they can help you. So tie into the local treasures, resources, and such. These pictures represent people who have some of these special interests. And my encouragement is for you, let's say Wendy or Alex or Kristen, to when you're working with youth, to tie them into what you're interested in first, because that's easier for you, and they can catch the excitement kind of for you more easily if you're talking about something that you really care about. So, you know, if hunting's your thing, you know, and you have kids that are interested in that, connect with kids in that way. So that way, you know, there's hiking, nature, artwork, you know, different types of, you know, learning watercolor, learning drawing, journaling is something that a lot of people like to do. There's a woman up there, Linda, her name is, she breeds turtles, box turtles. She's not very far away from here, and so she loves to share that knowledge with kids. She has areas where they overwinter, and she breeds them. She's really increased the turtle populations in some areas, and they're threatened. Not threatened, fishing, but the threatened in some areas due to habitat destruction and cars driving on them. There's a guy that likes to make oak baskets, so his, you know, knowledge about how to get that oak out of an oak, how to get those strips of wood out of an oak tree and make the baskets is something he loves to share. He's taught me a lot. I don't make the baskets, but I've certainly learned a lot about how oak is split. This picture, just in fact, that's me in that picture, and that's one of my grandsons about four or five years ago. And so we took that just to show the similarity between
So that's, he's holding a picture of his grandpa right there. But lots of people connect with the outdoors and photography now. And so, especially with the advent of digital photography being so cheap compared to what it used to be, that photography is kind of a cool thing. Trail cams, all those kinds of things are ways to get kids interested in nature through something you're interested in. So here's a personal example here. It's funny, my picture's got kind of distorted or something here. I like history. So I like interpreting history in the outdoors for kids. And the kind of history that I interpret sometimes is that I impersonate a man called Collier. And Colliers were guys that worked in the woods here in Pennsylvania and turned wood into charcoal for the iron furnaces. So I'll dress up like a guy and I'll be sleeping on the site, like where they used to make charcoal. Or I'll actually have a mound that I'm working on, a mound of wood with soil and stuff. And the kids will experience me, and I'll talk to them about how we used to do things, and then talk about how that the woods has changed since then. Because almost all the woods, even this woods, the woods that was on this site right here, was charcoal first, before it was turned into farmland by the center furnace. And then it was sold to, or given, this part was given to the university. When they were setting up the iron master, the man that was in charge of the furnace gate. So all the woods around here, all the mountain sides and such, were charcoaled off, completely clear cut, turned the wood into charcoal. So that's why these guys are kind of interesting to know about, because they can kind of tell the history of the forest. Okay, I know we've got another question for you here. So what are your interests? And this is a multiple choice one. So you can press 1 to 10, and 10 is the 0 on your clicker. You can press all 10, you can press 5, but be selective. I jabbered too long. We're gonna get doing something here in a few minutes. All right, so what do you think? Before we go to it, what do you think it's gonna show? Any group that I ever worked with, it shows that if you ask people what their interests are, you'll see roughly that almost every one of those things is chosen by somebody. In other words, people are interested in all kinds of things. Isn't that great? Because then you can have kids are interested in all kinds of things, and there's always somebody, an adult out there, who might be better at connecting with a kid or can help you connect with a kid about a particular interest. So let's see. Oh, we got a little on number 7, outdoor recreation. Okay, so that's the big one. But the other ones are all fairly close. Except that number 3. What's that there? Natural history. Okay, so that's no surprise.
History.
What's that?
I said history came out alone.
Yeah, I know it's not always, but I can bring it alive. Okay. So a couple of resources here. So How to Raise a Wild Child, and it's Scott Sampson. Anybody know him? You know, Dinosaur Train? I think they call him the Dinosaur Doctor. Haven't seen him? Okay. I mean, I don't watch it either, but my grandkids might be watching sometimes with them. It's fun. So now he's the director of the Paleontology Museum of Denver, I think, which is a big one. Another one, maybe. You've heard of that, Jason?
Yeah, I know John Young.
Coyote's Guide to Connecting with Nature. Okay, this is quite a resource. I mean, this is dense. It's got a lot of great stuff in it. And so I'm recommending 3 things here. This one here, How to Raise a Wild Child. This one here, Coyote's Guide. And this last one is called Sharing Nature with Children. And these are just little tiny paperbacks, 1 and 2. And that one down below, that where it says 20th anniversary, I think almost we're up to the 30th anniversary on that one. It's been around a long time. And the guy, Joseph Cornell, wrote these years ago, and these are like classics. There are other books, many other books, with curriculum and ideas. These are just 3 that I have used over the years and recommend. Okay, what I want to do is some what-if scenarios, and we don't have lots of times, so we'll only do a few of these. I put in a bunch just in case we have time. And a what-if scenario is just a scenario that I've created. In this case here is, you receive a phone call from a local school teacher, a fourth grade, teacher, and she wants to know if you have anything to offer related to Penn's Woods. And where it says quotes, that's the language that the person is using that's called to you. And this is for her class. She mentions that that they don't have any funds for field trips this year, so she needs to keep it on the school grounds and in the classroom. People always give you some, you know, parameters that they have to work with. And so if you have a scenario like that, what I want you to think about is any great ideas that you might have, or any red flags, in other words, concerns that you might have about this program. Any youth protection concerns, and what that means is really the law in Pennsylvania in terms of how you can work with kids, and I'm not spending much time on that today, but I'll point out some concerns as we go along. Or any follow-up questions you might need to ask the teacher. Okay, right now we know it's a fourth grade class, you've got to basically go to the school, talk about Penn's Woods, and whatever that means to you might mean something different than it means to her. Okay, so that's a good one. Any red flags here about protecting the kids and such? Let me kind of give you the Penn State approach here, okay? At Penn State, we can't work with kids under the age of 18 unless we're clear, background checks, all that kind of stuff. And even then, there should always be two clear people, two approved adults to work with you. In this case, though, you're going to the school, so it's off university property, and you have a teacher who's been cleared and such. So as long as you're with the kids, you're okay.
And the teacher's with the kids.
And the teacher's with the kids, yeah. Did I say that wrong? As long as the teacher's with you and the kids, then you're okay. Because you're just an invited guest there, and the teacher's really in charge of those kids in terms of protecting them from any harm that might occur. So you're okay. Even here at Penn State, if like a school group comes to this lab, they want to do a field trip here, that's fine. Any of us can meet with them and talk to them. We don't have to have all the clearances and such because they're with their teacher and they're visiting here. Same with a fair that might be organized here in the lobby or the atrium. If it's kids and their parents coming in, that's no problem. The university would like everybody to go through sort of the basic, compliance training, which I'm trying to think of the right mandatory reporter training, compliance training, so that if you notice something like a kid being abused by their parent, you know how to report it. But otherwise, you don't have to go through all the full background checks just to work with at a public program with the parents and the kids together. Okay, anything else you'd want to do? So Jason touched on asking for the more information about the objectives. I would probably want to go see that school grounds first if I didn't already know what it was like. Because if we want to talk about Penn's Woods, it would be good to find out if at least there are some trees on that ground. You want to learn more about the school.
And you might ask them if they've done any other programs on Penn's Woods this year or last year.
Yeah, have they been anywhere? How big the school group is? Yeah. And then a big one for me anymore, and I don't do as many school program groups as I used to, but is any kids with special needs or individuals with a disability, okay? Not disabled individuals, but individuals with a disability that we need to be concerned about. And in some instances that can be challenging, but if it's on the school grounds, usually it's not. Okay, so we won't go and elaborate on these too much because I just kind of want to make a few points. So here's another one. You receive an office visit. So I'm assuming you're out of college, you're working in some office, maybe for some agency or something. Doesn't matter which one it is. But you're recognized as a natural resource related person. And you receive an office visit from a homeschooling parent who's interested to know if you could teach a group of elementary and middle school level kids, because these are homeschooling groups, and they tend to be mixed age, about birds, okay? He's active with a county-based homeschooling education group and is willing to host something on his own forest land property. Okay, so any ideas or red flags here right away? Yeah.
I'd be asking about liability on this property and make sure everybody's like covered as far as, you know, if there are any accidents or anything, make sure it's not going to somehow come back on you.
Sure, yeah. So it's most of the liability is his there because it's his property and he's inviting people. So it's not as big a red flag as could be. Anyway, yeah.
The age groups of kids is pretty distinct. Now, in homeschool groups, a lot of them learn together in those mixed groups, but still, I preferably want to have at least two instructors to kind of break them up for different activities.
Good point. And I wasn't thinking along that line.
So at least two instructors, maybe three, you know, that you can break them up. How big is this group? You know, if it's 30 kids, you're going to break it up anyway, probably. If it's three or four kids, it might not matter. So what else? So we're talking a little bit more specifically about homeschooling groups. Any special kinds of considerations here about homeschoolers?
Well, I guess a couple of things about birds. So ideally, binoculars, do you have the resources and things like that?
Okay.
Also, some homeschooling groups are very, say, not anti-science per se might be the thing. And myself personally, we're a science-based organization, so we're going to talk about scientific understanding, and sometimes you'll get challenged. Well, don't talk about this thing or don't talk about that. And,
I'd probably come back at you with, I think homeschooling groups are okay with science, but they're not necessarily okay with evolutionary.
That's what I meant to say.
So that's something you want to be cautious about. And you know, you don't have to talk about evolution too much with the kids when you're teaching them about birds. You know, they're learning basic biology and things like that. They're not, you know, the origin of the species and the origin of life is really a bigger question, a question for older kids anyway. So, not the correct education, but we homeschooled our kids, and you know, we're serious Christians, our family is, but it doesn't mean we're anti-science. We just believe things were created rather than just happened by chance. Okay, so there's a distinction there, I guess. But anything else here? You know, it's hard, and Jason hit it with the fact that you're going to need more help. It's hard when you have mixed age groups to do a really good job. Parents can help a lot when you have mixed age groups, but it's still hard. Okay, you run into two neighbors who have children that need to do leaf collections for school this year. They know you're a naturalist, okay? And so they're hoping you might know some ways or something that could help their 10-year-olds learn leaf identification. Okay, so ideas, red flags, thoughts about this one? I'm going to pick on a few people because I didn't see your name tag over there, but I'm sure it's there. Hunter, perfect name for this. Hunting leaf. What would you do, Hunter? What do you think about this one? So I haven't even said what capacity, you know, they just know you're a naturalist, right? Maybe they just know you went to college for, you know.
I don't know, I'm trying to think of ways to teach the kids, like, how to look at different ways without doing their project for them.
Okay.
You know, like, you have to just coordinate with the parents and, like, hopefully you can just take them maybe around your neighborhood and look at the different kind of trees that they have right around their own house, or maybe teach them the different kind of trees they have in their own yard, and they might recognize them.
Okay.
In other places.
Gotcha. Kristen?
You can see what they already know so far.
Okay.
And then see when, like, probably the deadline on the project.
Yeah.
Send us on the books.
Alex, any thoughts?
I was kind of thinking, like, what you were thinking.
Okay.
Kind of figure out, and kind of choose, thinking what they already know, and compare that to, like, the trees around them, like, figure out where exactly they would want to learn the leaf identification,
mm-hmm.
and then kind of get an idea about what they're learning about at school already. Like, if they're told they have to do a leaf collection and told to go out and do it, or if they're already being taught certain things about trees, kind of figure out, and then you can base what you're teaching off of what they already know.
So all good things, mostly focused on the learning, right? The kids' actual learning. What jumps out to me first, if I was in this situation, is that there are some youth protection concerns here, because the way you do this program with the kids would matter. Even if you're not part of an organization, working with minors alone could be an issue, right? So my suggestion here is, if you want to work with just these two kids, you want to work with a parent of each of the kids. Because you always, you know,
child's not a, like a, and they can't be a witness or something. If the child's not a proper, at the proper age level, you know, for you to be working alone with. But the bigger thing here is that if there's two kids doing this, there's probably a whole bunch more, right, in school, in class. So here's an opportunity. Let's say you're working for a nature center, you're working for another group. You have an opportunity to say, hey, well, who's the teacher? Maybe we can do a program for you all. You know, we can teach you about leaf identification or trees and such and do it as a group. So that's where I would go with something like this. Rather than to spend all my time with the two neighbor kids, unless you were closely knit neighborhood and you were trying to do it, but even then I'd make sure the parents were in.
I think there's a golden opportunity to try to get the parents in a mentoring process as well.
That's what I was thinking too. Yeah. I mean, really, there's no reason the parents could be teaching themselves and then teaching the kids, and then it goes back to that.
Yeah, the parents could go back to the classroom. So you could train the parents too,
right,
on the technique for them using the key or something.
Yeah, that's really the basis of what you're
doing. And they're 10-year-olds, I'm just thinking, well, okay, I threw this one in here because a lot of people, you know, in society, will think of you as a naturalist. Do you hear that term, Jason?
Funnily, when I tell people I'm a naturalist, they think that you're somebody that runs around naked.
Yes.
Apparently, there's some kind of, like, so.
You're a naturalist.
So I either get that response or like, oh, what does that mean?
Yeah. Well, and I know that term because it's like nudist societies are the national naturalist. But I've gotten calls over the years where, you know, I pick up the phone, and this is even in my work for the past 30 years, and somebody will say, are you the naturalist?
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, well, I could be. What are you calling about? You know, they just use that term quite a bit. It means someone who knows about nature. Okay. Let's do one more here because we're running down here. So a county Envirothon organizer asks you to help with the wildlife station this year. The county's WCO, that happens to be the Wildlife Conservation Officer, Game Warden, it used to be called, will be setting it up, but needs people interested in wildlife, quote unquote, to help run the students through. This is an all-morning event at a small state park in your county. Okay? How would you approach this one? We're going to come to Wendy here. What would you do here? I shouldn't have put them in. Do you know about Envirothons?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have them in there? Okay. Danielle, do you know about Envirothons? No, because all right. Carly?
Yeah,
you know about
it. I feel like it seems fairly straightforward to me. I've been to Envirothons before and
in Pennsylvania, these are big deals. Okay? If you're new in an agency or whatever and you're just starting out, maybe your role is not as a youth educator, but as, you know, a natural resource manager of some sort, or a biologist. This is an opportunity to meet people who are in education in wildlife in your area. So sometimes these scenarios are for your benefit. You know, they become opportunities for you. That was the point I wanted to make with this one. But I'm going to jump ahead. I had a bunch of them there. So tell me about your future dream job and how you might get there. Okay? You don't have a lot of time, but I'm going to pick on, let's say, one person. How about you? What would be your future dream job?
I wanted to be a wildlife biologist for like a federal agency.
Okay, good. How are you going to get there?
I'm trying to get my master's degree.
Okay.
And get some good field experience.
All right. And
just work on it, I guess.
Is that going to, you know, get your master's degree and all of a sudden you get offered a job?
No.
So how are you going to get there from there?
You got to work your way up, I think.
But if you're not in the door yet, right, how are you going to work your way up?
Meeting
people, so connections, right? Right. Connections can teach you a lot, can't they? All right. Any other ideas about what you might do here? What Hunter might do? Maybe we'll focus on his. All right. Let's move ahead.
Try to see the internships now.
Yeah. All right. So let me give you some personal suggestions. Okay. And these are my personal suggestions. I've given a lot of students over the years. I raised three sons. I didn't encourage any of them to go in any one particular direction. They all went in their own directions in life. And then over the 21st year of being here, it's like 20 and a half years I've been here, I
I really love talking to students, and I'm kind of paternalistic, you know, I'm sort of like, every student's sort of like one of my kids, so I like to talk to them about their lives, and some of the things I recommend to them is that they should really, in college, emphasize specific natural science or professional fields in your education. So if you're really interested in working with you, you know, being a wildlife biologist, being a ornithologist, being a forester and stuff is a great way to go. Okay. Now there's other ways that people get into environmental education careers, or avian education careers for that matter, but having specific, you know, training is a good thing, and it's very helpful. You can be more general and be like science ed and stuff like that. That's okay. But sometimes being, you know, going in specific in a field where you're, that you love is more satisfying, I'll put it that way. It can get you the kinds of jobs that will then lead to environmental opportunities. So seek opportunities to gain environmental teaching experience. And I'll suggest some of those more in depth here in a little bit. Join conservation professional organizations. It's a biggie. That's how you're going to make connections. You're going to make connections by being in the Wildlife Society, the student group here. You're going to make connections by being, maybe going to some of the state college bird club meeting organizations, being involved in them, not just going once, but being involved, getting to know those people. All those people are going to help you, kind of help guide you. There's this old thinking, you know, in the United States, you have to claw your way to the top. Well, in fact, it's people that help you up along the way, they give you a lift up, they guide you, they give you suggestions. Conservation organizations are groups like, you know, Audubon Society, or even in the hunting game area, you have the National Wild Turkey Federation, Pheasants Forever group, or whatever. Those are conservation groups. Professional organizations are like among wildlife biologists or among foresters. Foresters have a group called the Society of American Foresters. Hydrologists, you know, people in the water have their own groups. So those are professional associations. Those are just for like-trained people. And then this is really important. People don't understand this so much, but I've kind of said it a few times today, is that you want to be open to a starting position in your discipline, even if they don't include environmental education in the job description. So, Danielle, what's your research on? Is it in South Carolina?
No,
birds. Oh, birds. Okay. So let's say Danielle's, you know, all your work's in birds, and you get a job with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, right? And they say nothing in the job description about environmental ed opportunities, right? And that you're going to do some teaching and stuff. Don't worry, because you'll have the chance. Those organizations are approached all the time by people who want somebody from the National Fish and Wildlife Service to do some education. Or national organizations want people like yourself to get involved in helping develop curriculum. Or you have kids, and even though you're a wildlife biologist, your kids are going to school, and the teacher knows you're a wildlife biologist, and they want you to come in. You know what I mean? So you're going to have lots of opportunities to do it if you're receptive to it. I talk to kids, sometimes they show me the job description and talk about a specific job, and they say, yeah, but there's no environmental education in there. Don't worry. Because environmental education, if an organization is worth working for, they're going to be doing some kind of environmental education work. Okay. I'm not saying it's always this way, but it almost always is this way. And lots of times, students have left, and they come back and say, you were so right, you know, I have all these opportunities, and nobody else in the organization wants to do it. They always refer all the youth kind of opportunities to me.
Well, the other thing is that's really a specialization that a lot of organizations just don't have.
And they don't have.
You know, and so there are few of them that you're looking for. But,
yeah.
But really, if you got into the organization,
you get in there, and then all of a sudden these things become very clear. I mean, you may find out the first day that nobody wants to work with youth groups except you. So you'll have a lot of chances. And then I say consider state over federal agencies. So Hunter said he wants to work with the federal Fish and Wildlife Service. Well, Pennsylvania's got the Game Commission. Okay, we have, and generally in Pennsylvania we think of WCOs. So we have kind of a regimented system here. But most state agencies are not like the Game Commission. Most state agencies are like a direct state agency for wildlife management and conservation. And they have educators. And they have people that will
do education, so that you could be a biologist for DEC in New York, that's the Department of Environmental Conservation, and you'll be asked to do school stuff all the time. The Game Commission here, if you're to become a WCO, lots of times it's more of the emphasis is on law enforcement, like either military, police, or something like that. But they do hire, more and more they're hiring graduates from here, and some of those graduates then, as WCOs, do get involved in a lot of youth stuff. But they promote from within, so you have to be a WCO first if you want to be an education and information officer at a regional level. It's kind of not very forward thinking. The Fish and Boat Commission, on the other hand, they hire educators to work as educators. You don't have to be an enforcement officer first. So those are some personal suggestions. Local opportunities, things you can do here while you're in college. Some of these you might recognize, some you might not have heard of. One is that the TWS, Wildlife Society students, every year put on a program called Kids Go Wild, and that's in the fall. It's just out here in the lobby, kind of an emphasis on just interacting with kids about wildlife, getting kids excited about wildlife. There's also an event over in the Ag Arena. Yes, and sometimes our students are involved
yeah.
in there. Yeah,
that's at Easter. Right?
Oh, Easter
yeah,
time, that's right.
Right.
What's the name of that one? It's called Wildlife.
So Wild About Animals?
Wild About Animals.
Yeah, Wild About Animals.
Yeah. I didn't list that one. I do a program called Wildlife and Forestry Field Day with students in the spring. And then we have another program we started last year called Walk in the Woods. And that's for the general public. We did it last year and we had a birding station there and had two birders and they just loved it. And everybody that went to their station, all they had at their station was a table with some binoculars, and they just talked to people about birds. And we had about 125 people come to this program, and we had it in 60 locations across the state. But at this local one, we had it had stations, and one of them was the State College Bird Club. And only got two people, but if we had like five or six birds there, we just could have done something. They could have done so much more. Volunteer Shavers Creek, the Arboretum of Penn State is doing nature programs, all types of nature programs over here now. Millbrook Marsh, you guys have talked about that, and others. So local centers, local venues will take volunteers and interns. The Arboretum does interns. Does Shavers Creek do interns in summer?
Yeah, we have an environmental education intern program year-round.
Oh, year-round, that's right. Yeah. So those kinds of people, you get that experience and you combine it with your wildlife training or your forestry training, whatever your different majors are. And it can be. Scouting, 4-H connections, you know, groups like that you can connect with. Penn State on campus here every summer, they have summer youth camps in the Everly College of Science. And then Discovery Space, if you haven't heard of that, that's a big children's museum. And I say big because they moved from a small facility to a really big one, right here on Atherton, kind of down, trying to think, it's where the commercial printing used to be, and trying to intersection down there. It's very close. It's like a mile and a half from here. A big facility, children's museum, and they have natural science stuff in there. And then create your own. You know, there's ways to create your own opportunities. Talk to somebody like Margaret, talk to somebody like myself, and I might say, you know, we have a program coming up where we could use you to do something. So, different ways to get opportunities. Oh, that's it. Okay. So what I tried to do today was talk a little bit about mentoring kids and the kinds of things that build a nature connection with kids, and then also talk real practical. You know, program logistics are important too, and knowing how to design a program for your audience is something that comes with experience, but there's people who do it, like Jason and the people at Shaver Street could give you all sorts of advice if you were asked to do something, you know, just tap it, ask people. And myself, but I'm always available upstairs because generally it's best to just send an email and say, you know, when do you need it? I'd be happy to talk to you. Danielle here to talk about writing an article, right? So there's all kinds of opportunities. Yeah, and that's another opportunity I didn't mention here. Like Carly, I mentioned to Carly and some of her colleagues that if you ever want to write an article for a magazine, I work with a magazine. Let's talk about an idea for the article. And she wrote an idea about turtles. Published and that's another way to educate people. You don't just educate face to face, you can do it through articles, through photo stories, places like photo stories, photo
Dakota on journalism, so to speak. It's just a lot of ways to educate about nature other than face-to-face.
In a lot of ways, for you, build your resume, your experiences, yes. And really to set yourself up to be a person that's a little bit different when somebody's looking at
you. You know, yeah, it was my college record, yeah, it was my major that helped, but it's these other things that I did that I could talk more about and I was excited about, and the person that eventually hired them really liked those things. They liked, and they liked knowing that I had done all that extra stuff. Not that you have to spend hours on it, but you can still get involved in things and show that you were interested. And you didn't just do it so that it would look good on your resume. So Hunter, contacts are important, but experience is not right. It's diversity of experience.
All right, we're out of time, but thank you,
Sam.
Pass your clickers up here.